Coming to Christ is not just saying a prayer. He wants to move from receiving His grace to living in that grace. And so we want to start this morning, this series, entitled Bless, with a message entitled Menu for the Miraculous. This past week, I was sitting with a 24-hour fitness muscle man. If you put us next together, it would look like Fearless Fly next to Dumbo the elephant. And we were sitting at one of my favorite restaurants and having lunch. And I made sure to set that up. I'm reaching out to him, sharing the gospel with him, loving him. And I wanted to make sure we were at the right restaurant with the right menu, with the right selections. And so I was interested to observe what he would order. He ordered a salad. Okay, a muscle man ordering a salad is an oxymoron. I ordered a salmon. And I said, bro, muscle guys don't eat salad. But he says, bro, wait till you see this salad. So they brought my salmon out first, and then they brought his salad. There are salads, and then there are massive salads. I mean, there was beef, chicken in there. I said, bro, that ain't no salad. He says, I told you. But here's the deal. We ordered the right thing because we had the right menu, because we were in the right restaurant. We want a blessed life. You want to make sure you're at the right restaurant called the church, which provides the right menu called the Bible. And in the Bible, you have the fare of the right diet. And to be blessed and to be a blessing, Scripture tells us what should go from that menu into our lives after the resurrection. And the Lord was really clear. Right out of Easter, Peter, the ultimate chicken who denied the Lord, comes out, has a great moment, and he preaches the gospel. 3,000 get saved. Let's go to the text here in Acts chapter 2. Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are afar off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And so those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching of the word of God and the fellowship, which is fellowship, that word is koinonia, deep life sharing, to the breaking of bread. They had meals together and communion, as we'll have today, and the prayers, or a lifestyle of prayer. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles, or the sent ones. This is the text, the message, right coming out of Easter, that the Lord gives us the menu and the selections on the menu we're to download into our lives, not only to receive His favor, but to live in God's favor. These are four after Easter musts right off the menu of Scripture for a blessed life. So are you ready? We're going to journey through this. The first one is to be a devoted Christ follower and not a casual attender. Be a devoted Christ follower and not a casual attender. He says over here, we just read it in the text, repent. That word means simply to turn from self and sin to Christ Himself. To make a turn from where we get the word conversion. 158 people, some of you are in here, were converted. You were born again. You were justified and declared righteous last week. You have just started your journey into the blessed life. But now there needs to be the downloading of the diet off of the menu of Scripture. Jesus said this, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, not everyone who says it, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. For on that day, referring to a day, a judgment day, when we'll all stand before the Lord to give account for our lives, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then will I declare to them, watch this now, I never knew you. The word knew is this Greek word called ginoskos, which means a committed, intimate relationship. And the parallel there in the original language is the relationship that a husband has with his wife. And Jesus is after not a courtship. He's after a commitment. And the place at which we receive Christ and commit our lives to Him is the place we move from exploration, dating God, and courtship into a commitment. Many people today want the benefits of a marriage without the commitment of marriage. And I'll let it go at that for now, but we can't do that with God. The blessed life begins with a commitment where we're not just casual attenders, but we become committed Christ followers. That's why what we're teaching at that class right now is so important. Because you know, many people, they go to church, they say a prayer to receive Christ at Easter or Christmas, and nothing changes. It's because they haven't downloaded from God's menu in Scripture four things that are very, very important right off the bat. So that's where we're starting this series. So we commit to Jesus as Lord. That's a total life surrender. As I said, we turn from sin and self to Christ Himself, and we declare that surrender here in Scripture through baptism, water baptism by immersion. Immersion is a burial. When you come up out of water, there's a resurrection. Now, let me say something about baptism. They did it as soon as possible. Here's why. Baptism is more than having a potluck, getting food, getting your relatives, having lays, and going to the beach. Baptism is a powerful sacrament that opens the door to a next level of God's grace, presence, and power in our lives. That's why Jesus commanded everyone to be baptized. Baptism opens the door for the grace of God to increase and intensify into your life. Where we're going as we move forward is we're going to try to baptize people once we get them through the classes, and these classes will happen every week, every month, and you can jump in at any time. We're going to baptize you. I'm talking to those of you who haven't been baptized that are new believers, as soon as possible. You can have the public baptism, you know, with the lab, invite your friends, your family, your brothers, your sisters, go beach, go diving, hukilau, and all that. You can have the public baptism later with your grace group or your friends. But we need to get about the Father's business, look at what's off this menu, and we need to get you baptized ASAP. Know God, follow God. It's a commitment. Sometimes we want the benefits of the blessed life without total surrender. I came to Jesus over 40 years ago. Primarily, there's always going to be one thing that holds you back from a commitment. Sometimes we want to court God. We want to be a casual attender and a convenient experiencer of the gospel, and yet we want the full-time blessing. That never works. If I told my wife, honey, you're number one, Felicia's number two, and Josephina's number three, but I'm most of the time I'll be with you, but I need to have my casual connections. What do you think my wife will say to me? That's right. I read your mind. She would say, not over my dead body. See, but that's what we do with Jesus sometimes. We want a good part of Jesus, but we want other things. Years ago, the big thing that I had to let go of back in 1973... late 73 when I came to Jesus was this. Not the plexiglass, but the drums. Music was my idol. Music was my life. Music was making me, at 19, a lot of money. I was making more money than my father was earning in his job. And I wasn't very good. I created essentially no drama as a drummer. I just kept the beat. There was no diva in me. I wasn't good enough to be one. But I was good enough to work. But the Lord was talking to me. He says, for others that might be good, but my will for you is to surrender your music to me as your maker. And here's, I knew this early on because I've called you to the ministry. Now, some of you are going, what do you mean? I'm going to surrender and I'm going to be on pastor? No. But for me, the will of God was not that I continue to play that, because God created music. That in itself is not evil. And so what I did was I came to church, acted like everybody else, but inside I knew in the clubs as I was playing that, this would be a hiding place where I could kind of publicly show everybody I'm a Christ follower, but privately I was in what they call today the drummer's cave. Well, in the cave, you can hide. But you can't hide from God. But I did, so I went in. And here I am. I'm assuming you can hear me. And yet, although others couldn't tell, this is what was separating me from courtship into commitment. And the Lord was talking to me. He says, you'll never have the blessed life until you have total surrender to me. I need to be Lord of all, or I'm not Lord at all, and you'll just look like one. You know, it's like in that scripture, Lord, I did this for you, I did this for you, I did this for you. I lived a good life. I did good things. I helped people. When we stand before the Lord one day, that's going to count for nothing. What's going to count is the fact we received His grace, we received Christ by faith, and then we obeyed Him. We surrendered to Him, and we begin to download and live the menu that He's prescribed. Not a casual tender, but total commitment. So the problem is, this was standing in the way. Well, guess what? The cave became an escape pod. Doesn't this look like something from the Avengers where they pull the Hulk in and they drop him from the sky? And I was starting to escape. The initial effect of praying to receive Christ was being lost as I realized I couldn't let go of music. Music had me. I didn't have it. And God says, I made music and I want you, but the music has become your idol, and therefore, if I can't have you. I was wondering why I wasn't living the blessed life. And then the escape pod became a tomb. And I could tell the tomb, because stuff started happening and I started to go dark. And I tried to do the church thing. I tried to do the church thing, but it wasn't working, because the Lord says, I don't have you. I don't know you. Norman, you know about me, but you don't know me. And when you surrender to me, you will get to know me. And I want to bless you, but I got to have all of you. And that's what they're talking about in the Know God class right now. See, that's why some of you, if you've been coming, sometimes there are those, we court God when we're in trouble. We have a cry. We want God to be our fixer. God wants to be your Lord. And that's where the blessed life begins. He must be the one, the only. It's like me, when I look at Faye, my wife's praying for me right now as part of the intercession team. I can't go, honey, I love you, and then it's Josephina and Felicia. Jesus says, no, I am your all in all. I am your everything. I am Lord of all. Or there's no blessing. How's that for a start to the new series? We've got to clear up a lot of misconceptions about Easter. Because right after Easter, this is what Peter does. He pulls up the menu for the miraculous. It's a total surrender. So those of you that are in here today, that you received Christ recently, maybe not even on Easter, and you've never understood these kinds of things, we need to see you not in here next Sunday morning. During this service, we need to see you at Every Nation Leadership Institute through that door over there, receiving the teaching that will change your life. And then there's baptism. Baptism just opens the door for a deeper work. Listen, let me tell you about baptism. Peter talks to them about being baptized right away. I have people tell me, oh, I need to get my life right. I need to be perfect. No. We don't get ourselves ready for baptism. Baptism gets you ready for Him and life. See, that's why Jesus said, as soon as possible. Now, I'm not talking to you who have been baptized, but I'm talking to, if you haven't been baptized yet, and you've been exploring and courting, you need to be in that class next week. You don't need to be in here. You need to be in there, okay? Because the foundations of the faith are so, so vital. So not a casual attender, committed Christ follower, and then devote yourself to God's Word. Devote yourself to God's Word. Apostles' doctrine, the teaching. They devoted themselves. This is a consecration. For the Word of God, Hebrews says, is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. It's powerful, piercing, discerner. See, the Word of God that goes in us changes us. It's not just reading the words off of, I don't care if you download it on audio, you watch it visually, read it. Unless you eat the word, strength and transformation is never going to happen. You cannot watch Korean soap drama, okay, and change. I told the first service, I got off on them because a lot of them do. Don't, you know, look, this is not a judgment on K-dramas. How many of you watch K-dramas? Don't raise your hand. Because that's not going to change your life. There's so much conflict, pain, bitterness, and intensity on those dramas. You know what I think people watch it? They're trying to process their own issues with K-drama instead of the Word of God. And when you devote yourself to this book, something happens. Do you know how I learned to read? My mother, when I was very young, read children's Bible stories to me. She read scripture to me. I learned to read before I went to school because she kept putting Bible stories into me. My mother has Alzheimer's today. I'm going to close today's message referencing her. Did I come to Christ and have a blessed life right away? It took a long time. But eventually the Word of God will have effect because it was in me. You become what you eat, they say. And the blessed life, this gives you the fortification that you'll need to grow to the next level. Senator Breen Hariamoto is here with Cheryl this morning, members of our church for 17 years. He had pancreatic cancer, as you know. That story has gone viral nationally now to bat down legislation against physician-assisted suicide. He's alive today because when he could no longer read the word for himself while he was under treatment and he was too weak, Cheryl read scripture, the diet off the menu, God's word to him audibly. Is it any wonder he's healed today? Most of the time, people don't make it out of that kind of infirmity. The Word of God is quick and powerful. It's alive. It comes between the joints and marrow. It discerns the intent of your heart. The problem many of us don't live the blessed life is we don't take the word of the blesser and put it and read it and consume it on a daily, regular basis. How many of you want to be blessed? Let me tell you what, that's spiritual. I was going to say human growth hormone, that's wrong, creatine, that's wrong. Okay, that is just supernatural, just stuff going into you. It's like the green juice, it's like whoo, it's whoo, it's the stuff that makes you strong. I look at Senator Hariamoto today. What's the difference between Cheryl and Breen was the Word of God. What would happen in your life if you just ate the word and said, I rebuke the K-drama and I eat the word? Woo, baby. So much time we give to watching and reading and listening to so much stuff. I think God is saying, if you just devote yourself to my word, to scripture, watch it work inside of you, in your mind, in your spirit, in your soul. Come on, slap your neighbor and say, he is on it today. So, I want to give you a visual before I step out of here. It won't be long, I promise. Know God, follow God. Right at the Welcome Center, there's a picture here I took from my phone. I want you to burn this into your brain, those of you who are new, and maybe it's not the fact that you received Christ at Easter. I want to speak to those who are bringers, your Christ follower, your invited friends and family. You need to make sure they come back, okay? It's not just Easter and I did a religious duty. No, your job is to stay connected to them. Love them. I'm here because two people refused to give up on me, got me connected to a one-to-one book, and got me into a group, which we're going to talk about next. Nothing happens if people just come on Easter and they don't come back again. Nothing. They just have a religious moment and a religious experiment. And that, listen, you may be here. You go, oh, you're talking to me? No, yell at me. I'm not yelling at you. But I'm telling you, this is serious business. So next week, you want to be in the follow God class and not in the service. If you're new or this is all strange to you or you received the Lord last week. Now, here's the third thing. For the blessed life, Peter's very clear coming out of the resurrection and the ascension of Christ after Easter. Devote yourself to share life in a family of faith. Look here. They devoted themselves to fellowship. That word is koinonia. That does not mean having a soda at Zippy's and talking about UH football. That's a deep life sharing of soul and substance to the breaking of bread. Hebrews puts it this way, do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Let me clarify. When we come to the worship service, this is an assembly and a large congregation. This is more like a gathering of 371 small group, grace group families. On holidays, when the Nakanishi family or the Tanabe family, my in-laws, get together, it's everybody bringing their families. When we're born, we're not born into a hospital of a family reunion. We're born into one family. And everyone here, if you want the blessed life, if you want to be a blessing, everyone here needs to be born into a small group. And you need to be in it weekly. Not accidentally, not randomly, not conveniently, weekly. When we raised our children, they didn't kind of just show up every other week after they were born into the Nakanishi family. They were at the dinner table, they were in the family. It wasn't always exciting, it wasn't always pleasant, but that's how you grow into maturity. And the blessed life says, the small group, the grace group, they met house to house. There were no big church buildings. 3,000 got saved. Where did they meet? The Bible's clear. They met in homes. They met under trees and by rivers. And they met. They devoted themselves, Scripture says, steadfastly. A lot of you don't have the blessed life because you're not yet in a grace group, a small group. Let us help you get into one. And when you're into one, you just don't belong to one. You're there weekly. Say weekly. Because guess what? We make time for what's important for us. You know what the big, big deal is? I no more time. Yeah, but you get time for golf. You get time for karaoke. Right? You get time for other stuff. We make time. I see some of you, you're looking at me like, yeah. You know, we bump knuckles at the gym. You say, oh, some guys, they're trying to cut me some. They say, oh, it's good to see old guys in the gym. You're talking about them guys over there, right? Not this. Oh, no, Pastor Norman, you inspire us, bro. You mean you're skinny, and it's okay. You don't have to be big. And stop. You're trying to help me, a brother. You're harming a brother. But you inspire. At least you stay here. You steady. That's the key. You want a blessed life? Scripture's clear. This is not a church thing. This is a Bible thing. Don't just belong to a grace group. And if you don't belong to one, let us help you get into one. And when you're into one, go weekly. Say weekly. And don't just, it's not casual attendance. There's a commitment to this thing for your life to go to the next level so you can bless the world. That's essentially what it takes. So every one of us is born into a family. That's the model. And guess when we connect relationally, guess what? Miracles will happen more continually. Here's why. You have people praying for you, and we're praying for one another every week. You know what happens when you call the church and ask for prayer when you're in an emergency? What's the first question we ask you? Are you in a group? That's not what you want to hear sometimes. You want the pastor, you want Pastor Paris or Pastor Kalai to pray for you personally. We'll do it once. And then we'll say, to belong to this family, allow us to help you get into a family, a small group who will care for you, pray for you, get to know you, cover you, because that's 7 days a week. Because you're in front of them, things change. Let me show you a group that I was visiting here. I was in this. This is an interesting group. This group has gone from 5 to 17 people, like in the last 3 months. It was stuck at 5 people for a very long time, laid a good foundation. Had a guy come, and this is at Zippy's, Brick and Bread. Had a guy come this past week for the first time. He's new, pretty much doesn't know anything. And he sat there, and there were four of us that were there at first. And he's gone through some heavy stuff. Next to me was a guy who lives here from England now. He's been in the business world, very successful. And he said, I said, look, James, I want you to hear this guy's story. And we're, you know, eating oatmeal. That's what old guys do, right? So I said, when he was 22, he was going to meet his father, who was going to hand him over the business after a time of mentoring. On the way, he found out his father's plane crashed and he died. Traumatic. Then he married his high school sweetheart, who in the first few marriage proceeded to cheat on him and left him. How's that for a start into your mid-20s? This other guy's really listening. Then he said, I found the girl of my dreams, and we loved each other for 24 years, and then she died of cancer. By then, the guy's going, okay, I said, hang on, don't get depressed. But he's found a woman here, and they've been married, and he's in his early 70s, very successful, and he sounds like James Bond when he talks. I kid you not. He's an intriguing guy. And guess what? He's not yet quite over the line. But he said this, I've been coming for 4 months because I was in a church in England, an Anglican church, and they always look down on people. They call it high church. I told myself, I will never go into a group again. But I kept after him. He came. Now he's been coming. He said, I've never come more than once. He's telling the other guy that. You can see the other guy is getting. And then there's the guy next to him. I said, you're a businessman. Okay, great. I said, Ethan, tell this guy your story. He says, yeah, well, you know what? I came to group for 4 months before I ever walked into a church service. The way I came to the Lord and got established was through this group. But, he said, or a group like this, I was $500,000 in debt during the Great Recession. My business was spiraling out of the way, just out of control. And just being in a group that was sometimes boring saved my business. I got married. I got a family now. 15 years later, he said, it's a blessed life. But he said, this is the difference maker. Here's another guy. Spent 9.5 years in prison. I've been reaching out to him for aggravated assault and manslaughter, and he was guilty on all counts. But in prison, you get exposed to some religion. He gets a degree as a paralegal. Then he gets out, and he determines, I've got to make a change, and he gets his PhD in clinical psychology. But he doesn't yet know Jesus, but he's been coming to the group, and he says, I like this group. I'm not yet ready to come to the service, but there's something about this group that I like. And I said, okay, I couldn't get him to come Easter, but I said, all right, Andy, keep coming. He said, no, man, I have something about the group. And I just know, it's going to happen. You know why I know? That's what happened to me. And some people think it's all about just sneaking into a service when it's convenient and saying, thinking you're doing God a big favor, baloney. God doesn't want a courtship experience with you. He wants a commitment. He wants not you just to know about Him. He wants you to know God. Know Him. Know God. Follow God. Know God. Follow God. That's why those classes are so important. We've learned something over the years. People will come to Easter and disappear thinking that God done God a big favor. No, God's not after dating or courtship. He's after wanting to know you. And then it's about making a difference, which is next week's message. Because we've been put on this planet for a purpose. Once we know Him, we are to make Him known through the combination of our gifts and talents, our personality and our wiring, and our passion. And when all of that intersects with opportunity, vision, and need, kaboom! You become who God wants you to be, and you fulfill the purpose for which one day you'll stand before Him to give account. Serious business, gang. This is so good. So you're devoted to a small group, not a casual attender, but a committed Christ follower. You're devoted to God's Word. You're eating the Word. And then you're devoted to a group family. Let us get in there, and we'll close with this. You want to devote yourself to prayer, a life of prayer. Watch this. They devoted themselves to prayers, not a prayer, but it was a lifestyle. Jesus said this before He went to the cross, the week He went to the cross. he left his disciples with this. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Watch this. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And if you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Jesus is saying, not only will I answer your prayers, but the blessed life is one who prays for others. And when I answer prayers, I bless others through you. The blessed life is not about accumulating and receiving favor. It's about being a conduit to extend God's favor. That's why we're here. It's this whole powerful deal. Through prayer, what is prayer? We talk intimately to God. He talks intimately to us. And when you listen, just talk to him like how you talk to him. He'll talk to you in a way you understand. Talk to him about everything, anywhere. You want to know how I develop a relationship with God? I talk to him about everything, anywhere. In the bathroom, in the car, in the shower, as well as in my study, in my room. Yesterday I spent 2 hours and 40 minutes just praying for you. Talking to him about you. Okay, maybe not 2 hours, 40 minutes. Maybe 2 hours of that. 40 minutes was for me. You say, well, is that hard? No, just turn on some music, worship God. Just be with him. He loves to just be with you. It's being in love. Sometimes Faye and I, we're just with each other. Because we've been with each other for 37 years, you run out of stuff to talk about. So you're just with each other, right? You want to be with, pretend this is Faye. We're just with each other. Be with, sorry, Twinkle. That's what happens when you come into the green room, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? Just be with. Jesus is wanting just to be with you. And when you're with him, guess what happens? He'll whisper a word, a thought, a sentence. How do you think we got into this church, this building? In 1997, I was in a lazy boy chair praying. You've heard the story. And just out of the clear blue, I felt like the Lord tell me this one day will be our home. It was anything but. I don't know what it was, Timbertown or whatever it was. One day, this will be the place. So when we had to move out of Liebert and come here, even through the battles, there was deep down an assurance in spite of the fear that God had spoken that through prayer. It's the same way we got our house that was paid up for about a year, year and a half ago. When we bought that, the guy didn't want to sell it to us. He didn't want to sell us the fee simple. He didn't want to do anything. But I felt like the Lord told me, that's your house. You need to fight for it. Keep praying. Finally, the guy I talked to, my agent, said, what does he do? What doesn't he get about the fact we don't want to sell it to him? He said, well, he's a minister. They said, sold. We don't want to get in trouble with God. That's exactly what they said. But if you're not praying and you're not hearing, you quit. I would have missed out on the blessing. Am I blessed? Every time I think, where has the keys got? It's through prayer. Pray about, talk to him about everything and anything, anywhere. Because he'll speak to you. There have been times I've been sitting on the toilet and I've heard the Lord. Because that's the only time you pretty much sit still because we're so busy. That visual is very bad. I will stand up. Some of you prayer, God's just saying, shut up. I want to listen. I want you to listen to me. I'm going to talk to you. It's the little whisper. I love you. Follow me. What is this to you that you need to let? Is it a relationship, a hobby, a habit? Say, God, I can't. You know what? How I let go of that thing? I got down on my knees in July of 1973. I said, Lord, this prayer, I haven't yet committed. I'm still dating and courting God. I said, God, I love music. We got big money coming in. We got contract signed. I will serve you. Can I have both? And the Lord said, no, because that has you. And as long as that has you, I can't have all of you. You need to let go. Now, that was just God's will for me. I'm not saying being a musician is bad. What is your escape pod? Let go. Because until you do, it has you. And God doesn't. And the blessing will not be yours. You can come to church, you can do other things, you can try to serve, you can drive the shuttle, you can set up and break down to try to compensate for holding on. And the Lord says, no, it's not about religious works. I want your heart. Let go of that thing that keeps me from having all of you. That's where the blessed life begins. I'll close with this. My mother, who taught me how to read by reading children's Bible books to me. She has Alzheimer's, can't remember much, but she remembers she's a Christian. She remembers who Jesus is. She reads her Bible and she prays a lot. I'm here because of her prayers. I'm here because even though she knew years ago I was playing in the clubs and not living right, she never judged me. She said, son, I know what happens in those places. I said, Mom, you don't know what happens in those places. You old. She says, well, she didn't judge. I'll just pray for you. She would leave the door to her room open. She'd have a list. She would lift both hands up. She'd get down on her knees, which was so disgusting to me because my room was right across from hers, and she'd pray out loud. She would pray for her son, my son Norman. I pray, Lord, he surrender himself to you. There was time I wanted to just, Mom, can you play softly? Can you pray like silently? Well, guess what? You know, when I drop in on her every day, a lot of times, what is she doing? She's praying. She's praying for me. She remembers how to pray. She prays for me. She prays. And yet she forget what I do for a living. She asked me every then, you're still working? So what do you do for a living? I said, Mom, you prayed me into the kingdom of God. I'm pastor. She said, ah, good boy, good boy. I mean, the conversation, sometimes you have to be able to laugh. This is a picture of the funeral on February 22nd, which is family only. It's Pastor Randy leading the worship. That's my mother from the back. My daughter shot this picture. When he began to sing Amazing Grace, my mother lifted her hands and worshiped. It was moving for me, man. Tears came down my eyes. So my mother has the Kleenex in her hand. She goes, yeah. It's so good. Well, when I go to her, visit her, I'll see her next to her bed, same thing. I saw her in the patio recently, last night at the dinner table. I check on her, right, to make sure she's eating. Because our house is attached. In fact, right from here to that screen, I can see inside the house. I can, right there. So we live together, but it's kind of separate units. And often I'll see her at the dinner table with both hands in the air. At first I would go, what the heck is she doing? Eat already. And she's praying. Last night, I saw her with her hands in her hair going, and I know what that is. She rebuking the devil. I hope she was praying, don't you touch that son of mine, okay? And I was so blessed. She's having prayer before she eats, and I realized that's what she's always done. You know, sometimes we forget. We forget that selection off of the menu. And I remembered, Mom, that's why I'm here. You literally prayed me into the kingdom of God and the blessed life. Don't be a casual attender. Be a committed Christ follower. Devote yourself to His word, to small group, and of course, to a life of prayer.
Thanks for joining us. Visit our website at pearlside.org for more.